Welcome in the name of Jesus who calls us out as blessed. I'm Pastor Wongee, serving here at Aldersgate United Methodist Church, and welcome you to our online worship. We are the church and not the building. All are welcome here. Thank you for being with us here in worship, and if you are visiting with us online, please feel invited to say hello in the comments. Come, let us worship.
Good morning. We are Elizabeth and Devin, connecting with you from the 1,000-year-old twin Douglas fir trees in Mount Rainier National Park. Please join us for worship this morning. I will lead, and Devin will respond with you, the people. Hidden in the quiet of our morning, there is a blessing for us today.
Sheltered amidst the reeds of a busy world, there is a new life awaiting our care and attention.
Floating above the currents of trial and tribulation, a peaceful possibility approaches.
Swaddled in love and compassion of God's grace, a new beginning is preserved.
People of God, the embracing and affirming arms of God are reaching towards us with joy.
For we are God's children, holy and beloved.
Come, let us welcome God's embrace as we begin a new journey.
Let us worship with the confidence of God's abiding presence and rescuing love.
Let us share in the opening prayer together.
Mothering God, midwife of all our experiences and dreams, we thank you for the ways you have brought us into new life over and over again. We praise you for your protection of us when the threats of life ensue. We honor you for the cunning and ingenuity with which you have crafted our opportunities to grow and thrive. In humble devotion, we remember your rescuing intervention when the way has been difficult and the light has grown dim. Gathered as your people, wonderful and diverse, we join as one body in worship, remembering your saving spirit and embodying your creative purpose. Make yourself known to us as we worship, we pray. Amen.
Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. There's nothing you can do that can't be done. Nothing you can sing that can't be sung. Nothing you can say that you can learn how to play the game. It's easy. There's nothing you can make that can't be made. No one you can save that can't be saved. Nothing you can do that you can learn how to be when time. It's easy. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love, love. Love is all you need. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love is patient, love is kind. Love does not envy, does not boast. Love is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. Love is never easily angered. It keeps no record of right or wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always endures. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love, love. Love is all you need. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. There's nothing you can know. Nothing you can see that isn't shown. There's nowhere that you can be that is isn't where you were meant to be right now, it's easy. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need. But now there's three remain. Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love, love. Love is all you need. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love.
Good morning, church. Do you know who I am? That's right, it's Miss Jen. I just have big old sunglasses and a beach hat on, but you are still able to recognize me. And I think that's because one of the easiest ways that we can recognize and know people are through our sight and being able to see them. But there's also other ways that we can recognize people. We can recognize people sometimes by the smell, or by hearing. Do you have a grandpa who whistles all the time? Or my kids say that when they can hear my laughter and it doesn't matter if they see me or not, they know exactly where I am and that it's me. So we can recognize people through smell, through our sight, through hearing. But in today's story, Jesus asked, "Who am I?" And Peter answered, that you are the Son of God, you are the Messiah. He knew who Jesus was. And he knew that because of the way that Jesus made him feel. He knew because of the love that he knew Jesus had inside of him. And I think that is such a special gift, and it's a special gift that we all have. So we know who Jesus is because of his love. And that is an amazing thing. And I hope that we remember it forever, really. So will you pray with me? Thank you, God, for these kids. Thank you for this church and for our time together this morning. Thank you for allowing us to recognize each other, to recognize our friends and our family. And thank you for allowing us to know you, to recognize you, to feel your presence with Jesus's love. Amen. Thanks, church.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. And Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is a mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything that I believe in. Now I surrender. And Savior,
singing for the glory of the risen King and Savior. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me.
Let us pray. As I pray, I will pause for some moments midway through the prayer in which I invite you to share aloud any prayers for people and situations that you are carrying in your heart. You are invited also to share and post your prayers in the comments section as we pray. Let us pray. Providing parent, there are ways in which we have felt pressed down and hopeless, threatened by the realities of our times. We thank you that we are the church struggling as we continue to say our prayers and change towards doing anti-racist work towards and alongside solidarity with Black Lives Matter. Protect us as the waves of the waters of injustice, struggle, violence, and pain continue to crash around. We are people in need of your abiding presence. When our futures seem dim and the possibilities feel limited, grace us to turn towards you, to feel you, to hear your whispers to us as your blessed. Sustain us and deliver us towards new horizons and new shores through your transforming grace. Grant us the compassion and courage to share our blessings of who we say that you are for us and to reflect what we confess through what we do and how we live out being the church, community, ecclesia. By faith, make us people living counter narratives to the dominant narratives of our times. Empower us to reach out with swaddling love as the agents of healing you have created us to be. Enfold us as we say the names of your blessed in our hearts. The Maybee family and the congregation in remembering Lisa. We lift up Dorothy, Linda, Betty, Paul, Pam, Pete, Karen, Barbara, Bishop Yambasu's families and the people of Sierra Leone and the church, for Jason and Jessica, for us being and doing church through COVID-19, for people suffering from disasters of fire, tornadoes, floods, and hurricanes. May we listen to your spirit groanings with and for us. We pray, trusting you bring us to new life, to healing shores, to courage and compassion. We pray in the name of Jesus the Christ, the one whose power was embodied in love. Amen. And now let us share in the prayer Jesus taught us himself. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. I am Michelle Joyce, and I'm connecting with you from Snohomish, Washington. Draw near and hear the gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20, we'll be reading from the Inclusive Bible. When Jesus came to the neighborhood of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples this question: "What do people say about who the chosen one is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptizer, others say Elijah, and still others say Jeremiah, or maybe one of the prophets." "And you," he said, "who do you say that I am?" "You are the Messiah," Simon Peter answered, "the firstborn of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon Ben-Jonah. No mere mortal has revealed this to you, but my Abba God in heaven. I also tell you this, your name is now Rock. And on bedrock like this, I will build my community, and the jaws of death will not prevail against it. Here, I'll give you the keys to the reign of heaven. Whatever you declare bound on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you declare loosed on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then Jesus strictly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God.
Hello, church. I'm becoming more and more self-aware in the time of COVID-19 how much insider language I and we as the church use in being and doing church. We are becoming more aware, especially with our worship services being shared in more public and online spaces now. We are becoming church in new ways. This new ways is difficult. I want to acknowledge that being physically distanced is being felt as a deep loss and grief as we get through month after month of not being and doing church in this particular building the way that we are used to doing church. The grief is real. I don't know about you, but I had a deep cry with God in prayers this past week. I cannot even name all the ways I miss being at church. I know how to speak. I know I speak from a deep place of privilege as someone not suffering from any economic or impact to my physical health at this time. I also want to acknowledge that I'm grateful we, the church, choose to do no harm by being and doing church physically distanced. So what I share a name as being at church, specifically naming our understandings of church as the building, in all the ways we sat in the pews, whether we liked the pews or not, the ways we had coffee hour and fellowship hour, whether we particularly liked it or not, the passing of the peace with hugs and or not, that I name these to say it is a felt grief and loss. It is not to say that is all church is, where we gather in the building. I grieve the normal processes, though, that I would have done through, for example, saying your names out loud as you came up to the altar to share in the Holy Communion, or getting to know you in person as I bring the elements to you sitting in the back of the church, for example. I miss even the mistakes of saying the wrong name as the new pastor and being corrected as we try to build relationships of getting to know, see, understand each other as companions along this way of Christ. My body is feeling the loss of shared physical space where when in the preaching moment I can see in our shared gaze some physical sense of the aha or revelatory moment and confess together, surely God is in this place. I do experience this in new ways when we are in worship online on Sunday mornings and as I watch with you gathered online as the church, as community. It is not the same. It is different. It is new. I want to acknowledge the loss of how things used to be, how some of us may feel how church should be. I want to acknowledge that it's not easy becoming church on the way of becoming doing church through COVID-19. If and when we return to the physical building of the church, we will not be the same people, the same church community that we had been before COVID-19. We will be changed by this time of being physically distanced. Our faith will be different. we literally will not come back as the same body of Christ, as some of our members are now part of the testimony of the cloud of witnesses. We will not be the same church denominationally, as we share in the grief just this week with the death of Bishop Yambasu of Sierra Leone, and we acknowledge our loss as part of the global church. Our futures are changed as one part is changed. I want to acknowledge that we are experiencing grief as the church, and part of our grief is the loss of the physical, both in the death of physical bodies as well as the loss of being gathered together in physical spaces that we understand as part of the experience of being and doing church. One of the changes we are experiencing is that we are becoming more aware that we have new visitors in our online worship, and we delight in it. We are learning how to be more truly welcoming of our virtual visitors as we navigate through the COVID-19. In many ways, we who have been longtime members present at physical worship are ourselves now new visitors to online worship. I would like to hear how you are feeling. I'm trying to be mindful of how I'm feeling. It is not easy. Our church is learning to do church in new ways outside the brick and mortar of our space, physically distanced, and needing and wanting to be socially, spiritually connected. We want to, and we are being and doing church. It is different and new. I say that out loud because even though we all know it in our minds, I think in our hearts and in our bodies, we have set expectations that church would feel the same and that our online gathering had to create that same experience as when we were in person. It is not and has not been, and that is a loss that I think is helpful for us to pause and share together. Today's text in the Gospel of Matthew helps us to understand that church is not static, and the Word of God is not static. We are the living body of Christ, and we are sharing in the living Word of God. The word church is what we use to describe who we are, our mission and purpose. We often say we are the church, not the building, and in COVID-19, I think it's being revealed to us again that the church is not limited to our understanding of it as just brick and mortar. The rock, stone, cement that physically make up this building is not all that church is or means for us. The word church is used in the New Revised Standard Version, NRSV, for us insiders, as one translation, one interpretation from the original Greek text used in the Gospel of Matthew. The word intentionally chosen to translate and interpret the Greek word ecclesia, where our word ecclesia, or for ecclesiology, the study of the nature and structure of the Christian church, comes from. In the Inclusive Bible Version, the Greek word ecclesia is translated and interpreted as community. The Greek word ecclesia literally means called out. So you can say the church understands itself as called out, and the word ecclesia has, and in today's text, can reveal to us what it means to understand who we are as the called out, or church, or community. It is not a static state. It's being and doing ecclesia, being and doing called out, being and doing church, being and doing community, describing who we are and what we do. It is organic, and it is particular in context of time and space. I think this is being experienced right now during COVID-19. We, the church, is not the building, though certainly if we study church architecture over history, it can reveal to us how the church at that historical context understood who they were and what their mission and purpose was. The church, community, ecclesia, called out is what is often identified as the mission of God. It is in and through us as the people of God, the community, church, the living body of Christ that reveals the mission of God with and for our world. When we pray as the church, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," we are identifying ourselves as the hands and feet, the body of Christ, to carry out the mission of God and as partakers of that will of God being done on earth as in heaven. Let me share an experience of church on a personal level from my relationships with laity that has shaped who I am and my role as pastor and understanding, becoming, and being and doing this ecclesia, church, community, body of Christ, and as part of the called out. I remember what Judy, who wisely told me that, quote, "People remember what you do. What we do says who we say about Jesus." Let me repeat part of that again. What we do says who we say about Jesus. What we do says who we say about Jesus. In today's text, Jesus not only asks the disciples what the other people are saying about him, or this movement of Jesus and his followers, this ecclesia becoming, if you want to say, but he calls out Peter, who has now been on this way with Jesus, and as we have also followed along in the readings with Peter, Peter, who has been witness to through testimonies from others and Jesus himself. Today's asking of Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" is really a moment where the rubber hits the road. Let us remember with Peter some of the testimonies surrounding him. Remember the testimonies of his friends, the other 11 disciples, their witnesses confessing, "Truly you are the Son of God," in one version, which reminds us in Jesus' context in that ancient times, patriarchy ruled. Or in the inclusive version, the interpretation of the same words as, "You are indeed God's own," which speaks to and reminds us that how we confess who Jesus is still remains in the patriarchy that is part of our formation, both theologically and spiritually, and the importance of lifting up how that kind of exclusionary language limits not just us, but limits who God is. We, along with Peter, listen to other testimonies from persons, and in particular, a Canaanite woman who is rebelling with courage to live the only way possible for her and her daughter of life towards wholeness and healing. And it was through calling out Jesus to a possible counter narrative to that dominant narrative of exclusion at Jesus' time. We remember the compassion of Jesus comes into as he hears her words, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David." Again, using language reflecting the norms of that historical context, and her words, "Lord, help me." In the inclusive Bible, the translation we hear is language that is theologically more inclusive. We hear Jesus calling out today to the disciples, Peter, and to us as listeners today, "What do you say about the chosen one?" Or in the NRSV, the Messiah. And the highlight in today's reading of Jesus asking directly and intimately to Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter's response is, "You are the Messiah, the firstborn of the living God." And what follows is a renaming of Peter from Simon ben Jonah, meaning son of Jonah, again, language reflecting the patriarchal systems in Jesus' time, to naming Simon as Petra, Greek word for rock, from which his name is derived as Petra for Peter. Sharing different versions of the Bible helps highlight for us that there is no literal translation. Words are always interpreted. Who does the translating and interpretation is important. If the community, church, ecclesia, or translators is all men due to the systems of patriarchy, it is going to be different from translations and interpretations from those who are breaking down the harm embedded in those systems that continues to perpetrate harms of exclusion. One example in the history and practice of being and doing church can be tradition of what we call apostolic succession from Peter as the rock upon which the church is built. Just one interpretation which laid out the road for limiting the ecclesial structure of the church to only male clergy over the centuries. As those traditions and rules were changed over history, usually with much conflict and tension, like the one created by the Canaanite woman. And as we don't know what and how church will become through these challenging days of COVID, but we do know we are always, by nature of our understanding of the word for church, always organic and not static, as it is the witnesses of not just us as individuals and our responses to who do you personally say that Jesus is, but also what the collective, the communal response is doing what we say in our responses. So the question asked of Peter is asked of us all through the centuries. Who do you say that I am? Our individual testimonies are important as it becomes part of the witnesses of the gathered together as the ecclesia, the church, community, witnessing to the good news of Jesus the Christ, the Messiah. Who do you say that I am? A question especially organic in this time of COVID-19, as I also remember Judy's testimony. What we do says who we say about Jesus. As we follow alongside Peter next Sunday, we will see how much we stumble along doing what we confess. Peter's response in today's reading, so full of certainty, and that certainty, it falls apart in our readings for next week. The question is not so much about certainty in our answers, but opening up some inquiry, moving us out of our safe places of comfortable answers and inviting us into possibilities and imaginations of ever becoming the kingdom of God as envisioned by God. Our response to the questions, who do you say that I am, has everything to do with what we are willing to do and who we are willing to be. Our response to this question is risky. Risky is okay. Jesus was not about being safe and keeping himself safe as a rabbi in his time. Rather, he was about having courage and compassion to confront and challenge the systems that continue to marginalize people. And in Jesus' context, nothing, in fact, about God becoming human is safe. The biblical narrative reveals to us a God taking risks with humanity, with us. God becoming human, entering our suffering, and being present with us and for us in and through the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior. I've been asked if it's safe for me to talk on concerns that can be borderline political. For example, talking about Black Lives Matter and or talking about concerns of our LGBTQAI siblings. I think it would be more unsafe as a Christian confessing Jesus as Savior of the whole cosmos to not preach about what I interpret as part of God's concerns and cares. If I can't talk about LGBTQIA plus people and their struggles, then I can't talk about people suffering from homelessness. There are a disproportionate number of gay teens that are forced to leave home to be more safe. Teens who become homeless because it is safer than being at home and outcast by those who cannot love them fully. In a similar way, I cannot talk about our outreach missions with supporting the local food pantry without preaching about racism. On and on, when we talk about issues, we need to remember we are talking about people, God's people, blessed. And we need to remember we are talking about the whole person. A person is not just their skin color, not just their sexual orientation, not just their gender, not just their social class or education, and so forth. Let us remember that as long as we continue to define ourselves over and against others, and in the process deny folks their essential humanity, our responses to who Jesus is will be irrelevant. The world will not hear what we say as having any relevance and able to do anything that brings about real and doing and being change. How we answer, "Who do you say that I am?" has to recognize that God loves the world, that we are interrelated, and that salvation or change towards becoming together what God envisions, God's will, has to be more than just about us as individuals and us together as community, church, ecclesia, called out. Praise be to God for the testimonies we not only say, but we do as we call ourselves the church, community, ecclesia, called out in and through this COVID-19. We are changing. It's not easy. It is and will be different. The good news is that not even COVID will prevail against the love of God we proclaim and confess in and through Jesus Christ. May we be the living stones that builds the spiritual house, as noted in 1 Peter 2:5. May it be so. Amen. Thank you, Jason, on behalf of the church for the sharing, the gift of your musical gifts, your presence, your ministry with and among us. And I know how much our church appreciates at this time that we can be even 6 feet apart and to see you on online worship. It is a deep loss to us that we don't have the opportunity to share in-person worship again. And we trust that you are being called to a new context, a new community, a new church, and that you go with God's blessing and our prayers and blessings as well. Our church has prepared a gift for you, and I have placed it on the altar there that we bless, and for you to take the material gift as well as the gift of the companionship that we've had in ministries together, and you will be remembered. The gift is for both you and Jessica as we celebrate your upcoming wedding. May it be filled with joy. We would like to bless you and pray with you together. Friends, I invite you as we share in this prayer, this anointing, this blessing, this God moment of transition, if you would stretch out your hands towards Jason so that we may be of one spirit. And as we invite the Spirit, let us offer Jason on this new transition and journey with his fiancée, Jessica, a prayer for their future. Let us pray. God, who blesses us with your gift of grace and faith, we thank you for the opportunities that has borne fruit through our accompanying one another as the church together. We give you thanks with joy for Jason and the ways in which he testified to who you are, and in and through his music as part of who he is, to whom he testifies his gift of faith. We pray with and for him and his future, that though we may not be physically going with him, that we are held in your and each other's hearts. Anoint Jason and Jessica as they celebrate their upcoming marriage, and may they continue to experience and encounter what it means to be and live life as those named as blessed by you. We ask that Jason will continue to be encouraged, to strengthen, heal, and be a liberating presence with music with and for your people, wherever he is sent and to the communities he finds on the way with Jesus. We pray with gratitude for being and doing church together with Jason and trust that in all the times and especially through change and transitions, we continue to accompany one another in prayers, that we would continue to live out being and doing the music of Jesus in our souls. May we bless and go in peace. Amen.
All right, my lighthouse. One. In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence you won't let go, in the questions your truth will hold, your great love will lead us through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. Well, I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead us through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. You're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storm. Hey! My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I'll follow you.
my lighthouse. I will trust the promise. You carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore.
And risking a new way in the world. Let us go proclaiming and living our response to Jesus' question, who do you say that I am? May compassion flow in and through us as God's compassion flows over us. Blessed. Go in peace. Amen.